Namaskaram. Very happy to be here this evening with S.S. Maganand, who is Senior Advocate, Devotee of Bhagawan Sri Satya Sai Baba, Puttaparthi, India, and who is on the Central Trust of Sai Baba, and who has agreed to speak with us this evening about the lawsuit that the Central Trust has put in the court. We want to know the position now, where it is in the court, regarding the suit against Sri Satya Sai Loka Seva Trust at Mudanahalli. And I've asked Sir, if you'd be so kind as to put this story in a chronological order for the person who doesn't understand all of these points in the complaint, which it's out in the public now. What is the story that happened after Bhagawan Sri Satya Sai Baba on April 24th, 2011 left his body, began a very strange drama of a person who had been very close to Swami trying to hijack the Sri Satya Sai Central Trust, Swami's legacy, and of course the main goal of money, as I understand it. So with his help, maybe we'll get more clarity. Thank you, sir.
Madam, I think I need to give a bit of a background.
Please.
Before I come to the events post the Mahasamadhi. Sometime in the 70s, there's a gentleman called Madiyal Narayan Bhatt. He was a householder, but he lived a very pious life. He used to live in a place called Alike, and he had gathered with him a band of young people who were willing to sacrifice the comfort of their family life. They lived a celibacy, a life of bachelorhood, and for the purpose of education, because education was his first love. So he and his family gave the land and set up a school in Alike. Alike is in a very, very remote, small place in the district of Dakshin Kannada or South Kannada in the western part of Karnataka state in southern India. He then set up a school there, and it was running in a very small way, and some of his devotees and his followers, I would say, not devotees, they were living in Mudanahalli. And Mudanahalli, as you know, is an ancient place where one of India's foremost engineers was born, Sir M. Vishveshwaraya, and there was some educational activity that was taking place. So school was built by them in Mudanahalli. And the school just about managed to make two ends meet. They didn't have enough money. They had borrowed money, and they were finding it difficult to make two ends meet. But Narayan Bhatt and his other followers were all devotees of Bhagwan Baba, and they had faith in him. But unfortunately and suddenly, Mr. Narayan Bhatt died in a road accident. And everybody, all his followers, were in a state of complete, remorse and sorrow. And they didn't know how exactly they were going to go about after that. So they came to Baba and placed at his lotus feet and said, "Swami, this is what has happened. So you have to now take charge of these children and these schools." Swami took his time, and after he had enough confabulations with whoever he wanted to talk to, the entity which was then running the schools was called a society called Loka Seva Vrinda. And so Swami asked them, "Will your society agree to what I say?" Apparently they agreed. And it was at that point of time which I was not aware of. I came to know much later, and that's a long story which I have narrated elsewhere. I can maybe repeat it some other time. Bhagwan asked Mr. Narasimhamurthy and a few other people from Malike to go and see my father, late Mr. S. G. Sundaraswamy, who was a senior advocate, who was a former advocate general of our state. More than anything else, he was an ardent devotee of Bhagwan. He was also a member of the Karnataka Trust, Satsai Trust Karnataka. And requested my father to draft a document. So apparently my father drafted this deed, and Baba approved of it. And then the document was registered in Chikbalapur. The document provided that Bhagwan Baba will be the sole trustee. All the properties which belong to the Lok Seva Vrinda, they were all enumerated in the document itself. It said that all of them will belong henceforth to the Satya Sai Lok Seva Vrinda. And Bhagwan constituted two committees of management, one for Alike and one for Muddenhalli. And he designated chairman for each of those committees and a secretary. And these two committees were working to look after the school. And Swami found resources and saw to it that all the liabilities were completely discharged and the schools became completely free of liabilities. So he somehow continued to help this institution. And as sole trustee, he managed it. Several years later, I became, my father passed away in 1996, quite suddenly, arguing a case in court. And so when Baba used, in those years, Swami used to come to Bangalore very often. Swami also came to our house once in 1976. And the association and the love and the blessing of Swami continued. And it was sometime in the 98 or 99 that Swami once suddenly asked me and said that I should be a trustee in the medical trust. So ever since then, the close connection continued, and Swami, for some reason, bestowed a great deal of love and affection and blessing on our family. And so I was later associated in many capacities, and you know, Swami used to love you know, interacting with me and my family. And many of the trust affairs were entrusted to me for guidance, advice. And so many times Bhagwan asked me, Naganand, please think as to what should happen in future. So many discussions were held, and many times I placed suggestions to Bhagwan. It was only in the year 2008 that Baba actually said you'd prepare a document. So I explained to Baba what the document is, and the suggestion was that after Baba, this lifetime, the trustees of the Lok Seva Trust should be appointed by the Satya Sai Central Trust. Swami immediately accepted that idea. I prepared a deed of amendment and showed it to Bhagwan. He took his time, approved it, and said, yes, I'll give you a power of attorney. You please go and register the document in Chikbalapur. So Swami signed the power of attorney. He signed the deed of amendment. And the deed of amendment was a very small, short amendment, which simply said that after Bhagwan, the trustees of the Central Trust will appoint the trustees of the Lok Seva Trust. And ironically, this deed of amendment, I went to register, and Mr. Narayan Rao was one of the witnesses to the document, and I signed the document and was registered. So from 2008 till 2011, Swami continued as sole trustee, and only on his Mahasamadhi it became necessary for appointment of trustees. So a few days after Mahasamadhi, the trustees of the Central Trust, as you are all aware, about 6 or 8 months prior to Mahasamadhi, in Guru Purnima of 2010, Bhagwan appointed certain trust, four persons, to be trustees of the Satya Sai Central Trust. He also appointed a few of us as members of the Council of Management, of which I was one of them. And Swami, when after the Mahasamadhi, the Board of Trustees met, and they decided on my advice that they must appoint at least three people. And so there was some discussion that was held with Mr. Gangadhar Bhatt and others. And they suggested that they wanted me to be one of the trustees. They also said we want one Mr. B.R. Vasuki to be a trustee. Because Vasuki by then had become a great benefactor of Lok Seva Trust. He had contributed a lot of monies, manpower, resources. He had built a new building, the hostel building for the children there. And he was a constant visitor and a great source of support for these institutions. So they suggested his name. And the third name was, of course, Gangadhar Bhatt. So when this appointment was made, we were only three trustees. For some time, there was no difficulty. Everything was going on smoothly. And then Mr. Narasimhamurthy came forward and met Mr. Giri, who was then the member secretary, and pleaded with him to say that, you know, I have been associated with Bhagwan for so long, I must be made a trustee. And he put quite a bit of pressure and got other people to speak. He met all the other trustees, including me. He spoke to me also. And finally, it was decided that Mr. Narasimhamurthy will also become a trustee. And there was one or two more names also that was decided, and they also became trustees. Even after that, there was no difficulty. He continued. He was first appointed as the secretary of the trust, of the Lok Seva Trust. And he used to call the meetings. It went on for some time. And suddenly, I don't know what happened. You see, there is a building in Muddenhalli. When the university campus was being planned there, the Central Trust appointed Larsen and Toubro to be the contractors, and they constructed the building at a substantial cost. So this building was built, and there was, after Mahasamadhi, there was some move to start some prayer there and use it on a regular basis to allow public to go. It was at that point of time that the Central Trust felt that we should manage the property on our own, and there was some discussion that was held. Apparently, this was not to the liking of Mr. Narasimhamurthy, and that is when I think the first seed was planted in his mind that he should break away from Central Trust. Now, when this thought came to him, he did not activate it immediately, but I think it was a very well-planned strategy. There was one particular meeting that was held in my office in Bangalore. A number of things were discussed there about the code of conduct and other things. But they never brought up any issue relating to amendment to the trust deed, because apparently and obviously I would never agree for any such amendment. Because,
sir, can I just interrupt you, please?
Yes.
One moment. Was this the point in time that Narasimhamurthy began to write his letters and send them around the world, his emails? Was that coincidentally happening, simultaneously happening, or had it not started yet?
It had not started yet.
Okay.
Because the first step they wanted to take was to ensure that the control of the Central Trust over the Lok Seva Trust will get fractured. They wanted Central Trust control to go. And how did they do that? What they did was, they, without any discussion, without consent of the trustees, the previous evening we had a meeting, the next day morning, three of them went to the sub-registrar's office in Chikbalapur, presented a document to amend what Swami had done, and delete the clause which vested the power of appointing trustees in the Central Trust.
Are you saying that they changed Baba's actual words?
Absolutely.
Who of those three changed those words?
The three people who signed that document are Mr. Narasimhamurthy, Mr. Gangadhar Bhatt, and Mr. Narayan Rao. These are
Did they compose this document as well, or did they have an attorney help them?
I'm sure they had an attorney to help them. Because what happened was, the previous night there was a meeting, and the meeting concluded at about 8 o'clock, and I had to go out of station, so I took leave. Next morning at 10:30, they were all there in the sub-registrar's office in Chikbalapur with a document prepared on paper and, you know, on a stamp paper and ready for registration. And the sub-registrar was actually registering the document without my knowledge, without knowledge of Mr. Vasuki, who was not the trustee. So when this came to light, we got a copy of the document. Mr. Vasuki felt very upset and slighted. So in a huff, he resigned. He said, I don't want to be party to this. And that is the starting point. When what they did with the amendment was, the power to appoint, which was given to the Central Trust, was taken away. And that power vested in the board of trustees themselves. So they took the power to themselves.
And the sub-registrar, how did they identify themselves when they came? Don't you have to have some procedure to say, I am so-and-so?
No, they would have given their identity, the earlier document, and the appointment of these gentlemen as trustees was an action of the central trust. So there was documentary evidence to show that these people were trustees.
But trustees of
the Loka Seva Trust. And when they went to the sub-registrar, they presented to him a document which had only three signatures, and they probably did not tell him that there were other trustees who voted for or against or whatever it is.
Yes.
And the sub-registrar said, well, trustees have come, you are on the trustees, I am registering the document, and registered it. So when this came to light, that is when the rift started. And when he got his position made clear, they stopped sending me any notices for
can
the
board. Can we have the dateline of that?
I think it was on the 12th of September, 2012.
Mm-hmm.
If my recollection is right. And ever since then, so about approximately 1 year and odd, things were okay. After that, this problem arose. And that is when they started, till now, till that time, Madhusudan Naidu was a non-entity. Nobody had heard of him. I have never met him in my life, though I've been going nearly every week to Puttaparthi for so many years.
So Madhusudan Naidu is the person who says he is communicating messages that come to him directly from the Bhagwan Sri Sathya Sai Baba.
Exactly, that is.
But we had not heard of him until then.
Until then, I had not heard of him. He was nowhere in the picture. Many, many years ago, I understand that he was a student, and most students who play some role in the organization or in the ashram, I've met all of them. Because of the frequency of my visit, I had never seen this gentleman, and I had no interaction with him, nor did I know anything about him. But what happened was, some months after this document was registered, Mr. Narasimhamurthy started getting extremely ambitious and going around the world, writing mails everywhere and propounding this gentleman as a kind of medium to say that he is the person who is in touch with Bhagwan Baba. Now you see, just before this breakaway, Mr. Narasimhamurthy came and met me one day. And he told me, sir, Baba is giving me instructions. I have been Baba's devotee for so long. My whole life is Baba. And I am bound to implement the decisions and instructions given by Baba. So I said, what do you mean? And he said, you know, I have been getting instructions that I must set up schools. And I have been getting instructions that you go to such and such a place and the land will be available. Somebody will come and give you money and you start a school there. So, you must not prevent me from doing it. So I told him, I mean, why should I prevent you? Why should anyone prevent you? If you are doing good job, you can do it. But this thing about instructions being given by Baba after Mahasamadhi, you got to be a little circumspect about it. I'm not too sure how you can prove these things. And what will the world think about it if you go on telling them that I can just pick up the phone and speak to Baba? At that time, Madhusudan Naidu's name was not told to me. Madhusudan Naidu surfaced much later. But he seems to be a person who is placed in the front by Mr. Narasimhamurthy, being a person who is capable of this. I don't know what his powers are. He gives you, materializes chains and things like that, and you know, gives you gifts like Baba was giving. He is now also going around receiving letters like what Swami used to receive. I mean, these are all things which, give a great deal of anxiety and I would say, you know, distrust. But the most important thing is that I have heard directly, I mean, I am not speaking something which someone told me directly. They go to a particular person's house, contact his wife and say, Swami has sent a message. And here is a sari for you. This gentleman, the husband, says, Baba has given us enough. I don't think he is going to send us any sari, and my wife is not in need of the sari, so please come here and come up with these stories. I'm not going to follow you. This is a gentleman I met. This is what he told me personally in his house in Pune. And he has been a great devotee. Now, the modus operandi, if I may call it, that they adopted after that was, you see, Mr. C. Srinivas and Narasimha Murthy were two people who had a constant access to Bhagwan and physical proximity during Bhagwan's long stay in Vrindavan. And during those days, Swami used to stay there 3 months, 4 months, and wherever Swami travelled, usually if he went to Kodaikanal or Ooty with students, Swami would always like to have the warden along to be a kind of a, you know, watch over the boys and see how they conduct themselves, to be a disciplinarian. So Narasimhamurthy used to be with Baba on many of those trips. So it is these times that they had close knowledge about who was visiting Swami, who are the people who are giving money to Swami. Because during Swami's time, the information about donations and who was giving and how it was being given was all not shared with anyone. It was completely, you know, under Baba's own personal knowledge. And a few people in the accounts used to know it. There was no occasion for even the trustees to know about it. Even I didn't know about it. But these two gentlemen were close to him in the sense that they watched carefully, they kept notes. And they kept a note of every single donor who came, who had devotion to Bhagwan and gave money. And they started tapping them, calling them, asking them, saying, Swami has asked us to go to you and to tell you that you are going to give a donation of 25 lakhs.
So, sir, you are talking post Mahasamadhi. But in Kodaikanal, when Swami was very much alive and present, they were already recording in their minds who has the money. So they were interested in money from that time also.
I would look at it like this. What I think has happened is that these people had access to a lot of information about the donors of the trust and the people who are devotees of Bhagwan. And they have, you know, stored that information, and now they are misusing that information by going to those people to say, you are Swami devotee. Swami has now sent word. Now, I don't want to name, this is a very big donor who donates money. He and his wife are devotees. I am told, he's an industrialist. I am told that they have gone to him and he is now a benefactor and he has been donating money. And he says, well, they're doing good work, they set up a school, so I think, you know, I need to give money for the school. Of course, if somebody wants to give money and it's his or her money, central trust or me, we are not going to say anything about it. But the question is this how they should misuse Swami? And another great misuse, what they're doing, is that they are utilizing and putting out all of Swami's institutions as their own institutions. You see, they are claiming that the medical relief work that is going on, that has been done by Swami. And they are saying that, you know, Mr. C. Srinivas has not held any position in the trust for a long time, even before Mahasamadhi. There was some issues which, you know, made Swami to keep Srinivas at arm's length, at a distance. We all know it. Now, after Mahasamadhi, there's nobody to keep him at arm's length. So, whatever he says, in fact, just a few days ago, I met a person from Bombay, from the film world, and she said, you know, Baba's secretary had come. I said, what's his name? She couldn't recall. But she said, no, he was used to be in Vrindavan, he used to be talking about, you know, with us. And so the thing is, he is now tapped all connections and going to those people. And, you know, one of his donors, I understand, for the Raipur hospital is a gentleman called Kishore. Mr. Kishore is a donor to Swami's trust. There's one more gentleman called Kishore from Canada. I understand that he has also donated money. Now, every single substantial donor to the Central Trust is in their radar. They're zooming in there and telling them that here is Swami Madhusudan Naidu is able to talk to you, and you tell us what you want to say, and he's giving you an answer. It's just like Swami is physically there for you.
Okay, the Central Trust knows all of this. Why is it that it has taken this long for this information to come from you, sir, for public understanding? Why hasn't, or if you know, the Trust put out some announcements of their own, or articulated the situation in the way that you are? Why are they hesitant? Is there a reason they have been hesitant? Even when Mr. Isaac Tigret was residing in two full apartments which Baba gave him in residence and fully going to Mudanahalli, as I understand it, they did not ask him to leave, because he himself, Mr. Isaac Tigret, gave a big public announcement in front of the Ganesha temple gate, telling that it was of his own volition that he was leaving, that he was very good friends with the Central Trust. This is confusing to those of us who are devotees, who are small people and outsiders.
You know, what happened really is this, that shortly after this illegal amendment was made by them, they did another thing. Mr. Indulal Shah had become of feeble mind. As you know, he was the senior most trustee in the Central Trust. He used to preside over all the meetings of the Board of Trustees. And they sort of took advantage of this situation.
Mudanahalli.
Yes, that is Narasimurthy and others. And I gather that through his daughter and son-in-law, they were somehow able to persuade him to go to all their functions in Mudanahalli. In fact, Mr. Indulal Shah stopped coming to Puttaparthi and started attending all functions in Mudanahalli. Now, it was the decision that was taken was that instead of straight away going and fighting a case against them, we should talk to them. We should make them realize that what they're doing is not correct. So over 2 years, I mean, it's now looks like a long period of time, we had a number of meetings. We called all of them. We spoke to them individually. We spoke to them collectively. We spoke to them at a meeting where Indulal Shah himself was present. And we told them that what they're doing is not correct. All that we told them was, look here, this trust is Swami's trust. Swami looked after it from 1978 till Mahasamadhi. How can you say you will not have anything to do with this? The answer they gave was, no, we need to discuss with other people. They call themselves Tyagajivis. I don't know what Tyaga they've done. Tyagajivis is one who has given up all his attachments. If you are attached to your position as trustee so much that you are willing to do an illegal document and present a fake minutes, what tyaga have you done? No tyaga. So the thing is, we tried to convince them. Finally, they would agree, they would go back. Then we said, we will amend the document. You can take it back. And we told them, see, these are institutions which Bhagwan has run, which Bhagwan has nurtured. The Central Trust will do nothing to adversely affect them. If at all, we can come to help you if you need help. But otherwise, we have no intention of harming the institutions. They would not listen. Said, you give a deed of amendment. They circulated something which was complete nonsense. So this discussion went on. Finally, our trustees felt that we should write one more letter. So another long letter was written by Mr. Chakravarti, to which there was no reaction or response. And finally, you know, the statute of limitations says 3 years for us to file a suit. So just before the 3 years expired, we decided that we are going to file a suit. And we had a bit of a problem. because Indulal Shah was one of the trustees at that time, and obviously he didn't agree to join the suit. So we had to make him a defendant in the suit, put him on the side of Narasimhamurthy and others. Mr. Giri joined in the suit, but he had become very enfeebled, and you know, due to his ailments, he is not in completely good health. So he joined, and so the 3-year period that was taken was only this, nothing else. On the other limb of your question as to why this was not publicized. Now you see, the greatest concern that all of us have is how to protect and preserve Swami's name and sanctity. See, it's easy for us to make allegations against anyone and put it out in the press, but you must look at it how the media looks at things. What is media going to say about these allegations? This and is that going to reflect on Bhagwan's name and glory? I mean, this was the primary thing that was always working in the minds of the Central Trust. Though as a lawyer, I tried to tell them, said, see, if something wrong has happened, it is our duty, it is our dharma to tell people that this is wrong. And I must say that I have shared these things on more than one occasion, and some of it is available in public domain in many of my visits out of the country. I have spoken about it, I have explained as I am explaining to you now, and I said that this is what has happened. Now unfortunately that case went through a bit of a rigmarole. The Lok Seva Trust filed an application to say, this is a very technical objection, that this case should have been filed before the district judge and not before the civil judge in a different jurisdiction because it relates to a trust. That was the objection they filed. Our legal advice and decisions of the Supreme Court show that this objection is completely untenable objection. Our senior counsel argued, pointed out the law, but unfortunately the judge has ruled against us and said that the case should have been filed before the district judge. I cannot entertain it.
Do you know the name of that judge?
I forget the name. She is a lady judge sitting in Chikbalapur. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So how long did it take her to read the plaint? Wasn't it something like 1 year and several months?
How the litigation system works is that you file papers in court, the papers are just lying in the record, and when the matter is ready and it is heard, that is the time when the judge takes on the papers, reads them, hears arguments and pronounces an order.
So the case was heard?
Yes, the application filed by them to dismiss the case was heard by this judge.
By the one who
wrote the order.
Oh.
She heard it.
She actually heard the case.
Yes, she heard the case, she heard their application, she heard our objections, she heard the lawyers on both sides, and then she took some time and she passed an order to say that this case cannot continue here because it is filed in a wrong court.
Is she herself an advocate?
Most judges, before they become judges, they are advocates. So she would have, she's a junior judge, maybe about 5-10 years of experience. And we have been advised that the order is not in accordance with law, and a decision has been taken that we're going to challenge that order in an appeal which we are going to lodge, you know, very soon.
The appeal is asking for it to stay in the civil court of Kuala Lumpur.
Correct. The jurisdiction, you see, I can explain a bit. The application that we made was a very simple one, and our contention was that this amendment which was done in 2012, September 12th, that amendment is illegal because all the trustees did not approve it. And such an amendment you cannot make and take away the power which was given, a sacred power given by Bhagwan to Central Trust. You cannot take it away like that. That was our contention. So in our view, and as advised to us by our senior counsel, this was the right procedure that we followed. But, you know, in the hierarchy of courts, courts take views, and it has to be tested in an appellate court, and that's exactly what we are about to do. As of today, there is no appeal lodged yet, but
it there is, must be a deadline for the appeal.
In the next few days, it is going to be lodged, is what I believe.
You speak of your advocates and advisors for the Sri Satya Sai Baba Central Trust. I did not know there were separate lawyers.
Actually, I should clarify that.
Yeah.
You see, I have been, to the best of my knowledge, been the only lawyer whom Swami used to consult.
Yes.
For the Central Trust matters. But when a matter goes to court and I as a trustee am a party in a case, we need a person to represent all the trustees, and being a trustee I cannot appear in those proceedings in my capacity as a lawyer.
I see.
So we have to engage counsel, so we have engaged. There are two very senior lawyers, they have been devotees of Swami. In fact, one of them, Mr. K.G. Raghavan, his father was a judge in the High Court many years ago. He was a devotee of Baba, Justice K.R. Gopi Vallabha Iyengar. So Raghavan is a senior advocate. Another is Mr. B.M. Shyam Prasad, is also an eminent lawyer, a good civil lawyer. This gentleman's father is also a judge in the High Court, Justice Mallikarjun. So both these are the people whom the trust has engaged to represent it in this case.
So, and sir, for my own clarification, and I've read all of the documents that I've had access to, who are actually the trust members of Central Trust in Puttaparthi now, besides yourself?
We have now seven trustees.
Seven trustees.
Seven trustees. The oldest is Mr. T.K.K. Bhagwat, and then we have Mr. V. Srinivasan, Mr. K. Chakravarti, Dr. Vijay Kelkar, Justice A.P. Mishra, myself, and Mr. Ratnakar. These are the seven trustees who are holding
and
office today.
Is it true or a rumor that in order for anything to happen as a Central Trust Act, all trustees must be in agreement?
Actually, ever since Mahasamadhi, all decisions have been taken unanimously by the Board of Trustees.
Okay.
So we have not had any occasion when one trustee or more than one trustee says, I don't agree, I dissent. There's a lot of discussion, a lot of debate, viewpoints are expressed. Somebody may feel that something needs to be reconsidered. So that process goes on, and finally, till now, I mean, thanks to Bhagwan's grace, we have taken all decisions unanimously.
Do you think we will get updates coming directly from the trust or Radio Sai or from within the ashram itself? We being the devotees all over the world who are really struggling to get bits and pieces of news, and only a few people are giving that news, whereas Mudnahalli has hired bushels of journalists and incompetent writers and is paying them and doing all kinds of things. Whereas we of course, we have Baba's truth, but what is the reluctance to share things that are already over with? I can see the secretiveness of something that's in process, but we have a right, I think, the little people, we have a right to know what is happening to us. We want to know, will we get news, or do we have to rely on social media, which is not that reliable? We would like just a small statement, such and such a date, we went to court, such and such a date, our appeal was accepted, and this is the place we are at right now. That's all. We don't want like a big story.
I've always believed, and I continue to believe, that we should not hanker for publicity, but we should not withhold news. This is my personal view. Even now I maintain that the more we don't disclose, the more rumors are going to fly. And I believe that it is important for us at least put it out in our website, put it out in Sanatan Sarathi, I think we ought to do it. And yes, the process has started. I must tell you, the process has started. I am fairly confident that, you know, with Swami's blessing, we should be able to change the way we interact and communicate. And I agree with you entirely that there's a big machinery which is operating, you know, the publicity media of Mudanahalli. I agree with you.
So hopefully...
I agree with you that, you know, you must also understand, you see, during Swami's time, all communications were by Swami. You know, so many years that I was going there, there was no occasion for me to go to the office of the Central Trust and say, well, you know, I'm a trustee, I need some information, can you give me? There was no occasion. Because Swami had that information, and if Swami wanted me, that information to be with me, he would give it to me or have it to be sent to me. So this is how it was. It was all Swami-centric. Now with that suddenly disappearing, see, the people around, they also were very unsure as to what we should give information to whom.
And while I have this opportunity, I want to thank also our trust. I have great trust in our trust, and I feel that slowly the shyness or the reluctance to just share, we only want to know what is happening.
Correct.
I don't quite understand why that link isn't made with Radio Sai, because that's the perfect venue, but I don't understand.
And we'll see if we can start some kind of a news bulletin or a release that we can give on
Sanatana
a regular basis.
Sarati is yes. The perfect venue for
correct.
That too.
We'll try to do that.
Thank you, sir.
But you know, I just want to end this on one positive note. And that positive note is that if you take stock of what has happened in the last 5.5 years that have gone by, you will see the ashram is maintained well. There are people who are coming. Of course, the type of visitors has changed a bit. We have a large number of first-time visitors, second-time visitors, as compared to repeat visitors in the past. I've seen many of them are coming for the first time. They're not somebody who's been devotees for, you know, generations. So Swami is inviting them, Swami is attracting them, and we have a new breed of young people and others who are coming to the ashram. The ashram is spick and span as it used to be. The hospitals are running beautifully. We have a brand new general hospital building in Puttaparthi, thanks to devotees who came forward with that from America. We have finished an excellent water supply augmentation project and given it to the government. We have finished a new campus which Swami had announced at Mudanahalli, which is the university campus. A new research center has commenced. The work on it is at fast pace. It's at the final stage. Equipments have all come. Hopefully in the next 5 to 6 months time, the research center will be a state-of-the-art research center for attached to our university, which is going to do multidisciplinary research, is going to, you know, take shape and start operating. All the equipments in both the super speciality hospitals have been upgraded. The latest equipments have come. And we continue to have the love and affection of Seva Dal, who come and do so many things in the ashram. The All India organization is galvanized under a new All India president, Mr. Nimish Pandya. He's taken a number of new initiatives, and taking a cue from what you're saying, he's already set up a communication center which is sending out information about things that are happening. They are interacting with the media, and the media is carrying, you know, the Rishikesh Paduka program was carried widely across all the national media. It was a wonderful program. It's attracted a lot of attention. Now they've taken up a Swachh Bharat program, which our Prime Minister has announced. So what I'm saying is that everything is going on in a wonderful manner. Of course, there's always room for improvement. You know, nothing is perfect. We are human. Swami was perfect, but we have to follow him. So I think everybody is working towards it. You know, these are aberrations. Mudanahalli is an aberration. I think today, tomorrow, sometime in Swami's time, people will realize that, you know, this kind of a distraction for devotees is not something which is going to take, you know, hordes of people there. I mean, all activities are going on well. It's not that, you know, we need some so many crores more or less. But the concern is only this, that, you know, devotees are, you know, being led to believe certain things, which is, you know, difficult for us to sort of accept. Even as, you know, very, very old and staunch devotees of Bhagwan, personally also, I find it extremely difficult to believe that here's a gentleman. You know, even when Swami was with us in physical form, right, and many people, many very, very senior people, judges, they came and told me, I understand the situation. I don't expect anything. I just want to go there for his darshan. I don't mind sitting anywhere. Now, this was the level of interaction that we had with Bhagwan when he was in his physical frame in front of us. Can you imagine that Swami will be available on the phone for somebody who will pick up the phone and speak to him anytime? It's difficult for me to believe it. That's all I can say.
Sir, you were so charming and so gracious, and again, thank you for seeing us on this long day that you've had today.
Thank you.
And thank you everybody for your blessing.